عليه. اللهم صل على محمد في أول كلامنا، اللهم صل على محمد في أوسط كلامنا، اللهم صل على محمد في آخر كلامنا. Continuing with the discussion, mashallah, Mufti Saab covered a lot. Last time when I had this program, there was so much to cover, I didn't get a chance to cover all of it. And now we're talking about the more interesting stuff. It was a very interesting stuff, but now what happens when the Dajjal comes? What's going to happen, right? So one hadith of Rasulullah mentions that prior to the Dajjal coming, 3 years before the Dajjal comes, what's going to happen? 3 years before the Dajjal comes, the sky is going to decrease the rain by 1/3. The earth is going to stop its crops, 1/3 is going to decrease. 3 years before the Dajjal coming. 2 years before the Dajjal comes, what's going to happen? 2/3 of the sky is going to stop pouring rain, and 2/3 of the crops are going to stop being produced from the earth. And then the final year before the Dajjal comes, there will be no rain. It will be a complete drought. And there will be no crops being produced. It will be a complete famine. This will be the situation of the Ummah. This will be the situation, the condition of the world at that time. When there will be no skies, rahmat coming from the there will be no rahmat coming from the skies. There will be no food being grown from the earth. Allah will withhold this. So this is what Hadith Rasulullah shows, that before the Dajjal comes, calamities will fall upon the Ummah. That there will be chaos going around. But there will be one person who will be there, and that will be a person known as Imam Mahdi. And he will be leading an army, and that army will be fighting for the Muslims at that time, prior to the Dajjal coming. Imam Mahdi will be fighting an army, and the hadith of Rasulullah shows that Imam Mahdi will conquer Constantinople, Istanbul nowadays. Right? So this hadith shows that there's a possibility, it's most likely that Istanbul will be conquered again by the Christians. So before the Dajjal comes, Imam Mahdi will take his army and they will conquer Constantinople again. And while they're conquering Constantinople, the Hadith of Muslim mentions, they will be hanging the swords on the trees, celebrating the victory, collecting the spoils of war. And then Shaitan will make a whisper that the Dajjal has come. The Dajjal has finally come amongst you. So what Imam Mahdi will do, was Imam Mahdi will send riders to go and find out if this khabar is true, if this news is true, that the Dajjal has arrived, yes or no. So the narration mentions that when these riders go, and Rasulullah mentions that, wallahi, I know the names of these riders. I know their horses' names, and I know their lineage. And Rasulullah mentions that these will be the best people at that time, right? We should always remember that Rasulullah mentions in the hadith that every single generation, there will be flag bearers upholding the deen of Allah. Right? Right? In Wazahab al-Batul, right? That haq is such true where that it overpowers batul no matter what. So no matter how sometimes it may be that we have so much calamities around us, we might feel we're outnumbered, but haq will always overpower batul. This is the sunnah of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So Rasulullah is mentioning that he will send two horse riders, a couple of horse riders to find out. And this will be near Palestine. Palestine. Now when these riders go, they'll find out that this khabar was false. This news was false. But what happens? When they go, all of a sudden the Dajjal will make his appearance. And the hadith mentions how many people will be with him? 70,000 Yahud will be with him. 70,000 Jews will be supporting him, and they'll be wearing green shawls. So now the Dajjal has come. And the Dajjal has come, and like Mashallah Mufti Saab mentioned, he will last for 40 days. And because of the trial and the hardships afflicting the world at that time. Why? Because I mentioned, Rasulullah mentions, the year prior to the Dajjal coming, there will be no rain, there will be no crops. So where's the food? Where's the food going to be? So now the Dajjal will come, and that's his first fitna. That will be the fitna of having food and luxuries, where the Dajjal was saying of religion, you follow me and I'll give you some food. So he will say, I am a prophet. He will then claim that he is the Lord. He will have food with him. He will have the treasures. Allah will give him such as powers. And now there's a time where there's no food and there's no water. So he says, you listen to me, you follow me, you sell your religion, I'll give you food, I'll give you water. That's his first thing. Right? Hadith Rasulullah mentions that the fitna of the Dajjal, he will pass by a locality, and whoever rejects him, So now he'll pass by. The Dajjal will cover every single span of the earth. Every single land will be covered except Mecca and Medina. So he'll be flying, the hadith that Rasulullah mentions, like faster than the cloud. Right? The hadith that Rasulullah says, he will have a donkey. Right? But now, that doesn't necessarily literally refer to a donkey. If you look nowadays, it can be applied to a jet. Right? You see jets nowadays, how fast they travel the earth. Fighter jets, they have different jets. So this can be an instrument of the Dajjal. So he'll go to every single locality and he will say, if you reject me, there's no food for you. There's no water for you. But if you accept me, I'll give you water, I'll give you food. This is the first fitna of the Dajjal, the fitna of religion. Then the second fitna of the Dajjal is the test of wealth. Similarly, the same thing. Where the Dajjal, Allah Ta'ala will give him certain powers where he'll be walking with all the treasures of the earth. He will point at the earth and the earth will grow crops. Right? He will point at the sky and the sky will produce water. It will rain. So now he has all the wealth with him. So now he says, if you follow me, I will give you the wealth. So this will be the second fitna of the Dajjal. The third fitna of the Dajjal will be the test of knowledge. Right? And this is what's happening nowadays. The ignorant people are being chosen and ignorant people are being worshipped nowadays. Right? Where people are forgetting religion. What's being worshipped are people who have intellect. Right? People who don't follow religion. People who have the knowledge of the dunya. These are the people who society deems as people who are accepted in society. If you follow religion, you're deemed backwards. You're considered someone medieval. You're considered someone who is outdated. But people who are intellectual people, who follow their nafs, who involve themselves in the dunya, these are the people who nowadays media deems as successful people. People who have it all. So this will be the third fitna of the Dajjal, the fitna of knowledge, where he will deceive people and he will show that this is truth and this is wrong. But in reality, his truth will be wrong and his truth will be wrong and his wrong will be truth. How is this possible? If you look, like I mentioned nowadays, what kind of era are we living in? Right? We're living in a time where expressing yourself, right? Coming out, expressing yourself is deemed as wahwa, right? They say it's like, right? What happens? He came out of the closet and they're clapping for him, right? It's a sad reality. And he is expressing himself or he's opening to himself and let him be. Just as in the divisions of the Quran, that all these people are just following their nafs, their desires, and they're making their desires as gods. Right? I was in the city 2 weeks ago, and coincidentally, I happened to walk by the homosexual, the gay parade. It was disgusting, their pride that they're showing. And these are the people who society says, these are the people who are leaders. And this is what they put into our minds, that if you don't follow them, then they don't accept you, you're outcast. You're deemed backwards. It's how is this possible? And they say that Muslims, or anyone who follows religion, they're oppressed. They need liberation. We need to liberate them, right? They have niqab. This is not possible. They need to be liberated. Express yourself. Show yourself. So this is what the Dajjal will do. And this is happening, where following the dunya, having material luxury is considered good. And having religion is considered bad, right? If you have religion, you're considered someone who has nothing. But when you have a degree, or you have the dunya, or you have the luxuries, now you have been deemed as successful. You are the one who's successful in the eyes of the society. So this is what society has come to, where everything is being controlled by the media. Whatever the media wants to put in your head, that is what we understand. Right? We see in the media that so-and-so country, and this is what Mufti Saab mentioned, that why is it that people say America is the job? It's because nowadays America is such where one of the fitnas of the Dajjal is what? I mentioned this last time in my program, that he will show a spring. You have a Jannah with him, you have a Jahannam. Again, Jannah literally means garden. So you have a garden with him, and he will have a fire with him. And he will say, choose. Now Rasulullah says that the one who chooses his Jannah, in reality that's a fire. And the one who chooses his fire, in reality that is paradise. This is the deception of the Dajjal. How is this possible? And this is what the Western media is putting into our brain. That the places that have more dunya. Right? People who live back home, I mentioned this last time, that people who live back home, they have this desire to come to America. They have this desire to come to UK to chase the American dream. Right? You go in school, what do they teach you? I'm living the American dream. And what is the American dream? You're working day and night in financial slavery. There's nothing wrong with working. I'm not saying, I work myself also. But to put the dream, the dunya over the deen, this is what the people want. To put the dunya over the deen, where now you're involving yourself in the dunya, where you forget your Allah Azza wa Jal. We're chasing the dunya, having two cars, three cars, five houses. This is correct. So this is the deception of the Jal, where America is deemed as the Jannah. Everyone wants a green card. When people come here, they want to bring their family here. Right? The people have this feeling that I have to come to America. And then the reality is when they come to America, they're put into this trap. And then they hit. And we'll see later on, when the job comes, there's two ways of facing the job. How do you face the job? And one of the ways is hijrah, migrating. When Rasulullah first came, and he was given the book, what happened? After a couple of years, Allah told Nabi Kareem to migrate to Medina. He had to migrate. Why? Because that environment he was in was not supporting him. In order for you to progress, you need to change your environment. So we'll see how to face the job, one of the ways you face the job. So this is the third test of the job, knowledge. Right? He will deceive people. He will show what's right and what's wrong. And what's happening nowadays? Everything is being controlled by social media. You have Instagram, Facebook, you know, you have this game, even myself was involved in a Pokemon Go, right? Everyone was going around catching Pokemon, right? And you just see it, I was like walking on the street, everyone's going and going crazy. Oh my God, there's a Charizard there, right? And everyone's running for it. So now if people can do this, and they can involve themselves in this, what's the benefit of the job? If you see nowadays people, now right now the Euro is taking place, the Euro 2020, the football tournament, people are flying to witness this event. So it's not far-fetched that when the job comes, people will be flocking to him. If people are willing to go to these tournaments, if someone right now comes on social, on BBC News or Fox News, and he says that I am going to walk on water, the event is going to take place January 2022. Tickets are being sold now. Bam, everyone's going to be buying it on the spot. You know, there's a UFC fight, everyone's buying it. Again, I'm not saying it's haram, I'm just trying to explain to you how the fitna of the job works, that we're living in the sense that it's possible, it's modern day time. When someone announces there's a fight, they go for that fight. If someone announces that, I am going to walk on water. You see, everyone's going to be buying the tickets. People from around the world are going to be coming. Right? Even if it's a waste of time, whatever it may be, people want this thrill. So when the job comes, and you will have all these luxuries, you will have gardens with him. You will have the wealth of the earth. You will point at the earth, and the earth will grow gardens, and the earth will grow crops and food for the person. Now, who doesn't want to find that person? So this is what happens. This is the fit of the job, the deception of the job. Right? Social media puts a trend out there. Everyone's doing that trend. They don't know why they're doing it. Everyone's doing it. Right? And if you see, everything is becoming more vulgar and vulgar and vulgar. Right? It started off with something simple, and now women are exposing themselves on this fitna. And it's everywhere you look, this is one of the fitnas of the Dajjal, right? The Dajjal will have three tools to express his fitna. One will be wealth. He'll have all the treasures of the earth. Number two will be entertainment. Right? He'll control entertainment. Why? Because kuffar, their purpose in life, their core value in life is materialism. They don't have any concept of the hereafter. For them, this dunya is make it or break it. So they work their life trying to gain the dunya. And they'll put themselves in harm risk for the dunya. But as Muslims, we don't chase the materialists. We don't chase materials. Rather, our maqsad is the hereafter. And this would be the second fit of the Dajjal entertainment. Because there's a saying in Arabic, kullu jadid, ladhi. Everything new is tasty, right? You have a new slice of pizza downstairs. She's like, wow, it's delicious. 3 days later, 4 days later, I can't take it anymore. Right? It gets boring. So now that's what the social media does. That one trend, it gets boring, another trend quickly. Involving people in another trend. Right? Pokemon Go is dead now. Right? They tried as much as they could, but now they're trying to bring it back, it's not working. Right? You have different trends. This trend. Why? Because if the same trend keeps going, it gets boring. Insan's nature is such where they want new things. So that's the fit of the Dajjal. The second way he uses his tools, entertainment. And he has control over the whole thing. And the third one is woman. The fitna of the Dajjal is woman. Nabi Kareem Sosa mentions in the hadith that verily women were the cause of the downfall of the Banu Isma'il. And he warned us that they're the worst of the fitna of this ummah, besides wealth. The fitna of the woman. Allah says in the Quran, Inna kaydahunna azeem. Allah says in the Quran that the fitna of shaitan is weak. But he said that the fitna of a woman is very, it's intense. So Raja will have all three under these tools. Number one is wealth, number two is entertainment, and number three is woman. And the fourth fitna of the Dajjal is this test of power. Right? I mentioned this last time in my bayan, that if you want power, the Dajjal will come to you and say, if you want power, sell yourself to the Dajjal. So sell yourself to me. Sell your soul to me. And that's what's happening nowadays. People are selling themselves to Shaytan, to the devil. Why so? In exchange of the dunya. Right? You have all these pop stars, 90% of them, 99% of them, they have sold themselves to the devil. They have given themselves and they have sold their akhirat for the dunya. And they have exposed themselves. And this is what the Dajjal will tell them, that if you want to gain power, if you want power, follow me, sell your soul to me. And this is what the Dajjal will tell the people. So this will be the fortress of the Dajjal. Right? He will attack us spiritually, he will attack us mentally, he will attack us physically, and from everywhere, mentally, spiritually, physically, politically. Everything will be under his control. From wealth to power to entertainment to women. So majority of the people who will follow the Dajjal will be the Yahud and the women. Hadith of Rasul has mentioned something very interesting, that the time will come when the Dajjal comes, men will have to change their women in order to protect them from the fitna of the Dajjal. This is the time that will come. Right? And so we're living these times, it's not far-fetched. So now, what happens? The Dajjal comes, he lasts for 40 days. He has control over everything. He'll be walking, people will be trying to follow him. Now he will go to Makkah. He cannot go to Makkah. He'll go to Medina, and Medina, he cannot enter it. But that doesn't mean they're safe. People in Medina are not safe. Why? Hadith mentions that three earthquakes will occur in Medina. Three earthquakes. Now why these earthquakes will take place? Because whoever is a munafiq, whoever is not a true believer in Medina, they will come out. They will say, oh my God, it's an earthquake, let's get out. Once they go out, they'll fall into the fitna of the Dajjal. They will become followers of the Dajjal. The Dajjal will be waiting outside for them because he can't enter. So now an earthquake will take place. And then the munafiqeen at that time will come out from Medina. Then another earthquake, and then another earthquake. So three earthquakes will take place, and that will cleanse Medina from any munafiqeen. And these people will be thinking, I'm just trying to save myself. It's an earthquake, right? It's craziness. So they come out and they go into the fitna of the Dajjal. So no one will be safe. It will be a very hard time. And the Dajjal will be going around everywhere. And then finally he will come to Bayt al-Maqdis. And when he comes to Bayt al-Maqdis, he will see by the doors at this time, Imam Mahdi. I mentioned every era, before the day of the time of Qiyamah, before the major signs of Qiyamah, the last sign, every era, no matter how much time, no matter how the time may be where we are outnumbered or we have lost hope, there will always be an era of people, and there will always be people upholding the deen of Allah. So while this chaos is taking place, will the Dajjal will have miracles? The Dajjal will literally tell a person, do you want to see your parents? And the person will say, yes. So you have shayateen, you've been doing black magic. Obviously all this is because Allah gives him the ability to do so. So we have shayateen who will come in the form of a person's parents and say, look, I have brought your parents to accept me now as your Lord. Imagine, it's unimaginable, but it's possible. Mufisat mentioned that what's happening nowadays is if you go against a country nowadays, let's say America or UK, I don't want to go to politics. If you don't follow them, what happens? They give you sanctions. Isn't this what the Dajjal is going to do also? If you don't follow him, he's not give you food? So you have these countries who don't follow America, or don't follow the UK, or don't follow these first world countries, they get sanctioned immediately. They have the power to do that. So the Dajjal also has the same power. Right? You have these countries who nowadays, everything that we eat is being mass produced. Right? It's all owned by major big corporations. If they want, they can stop giving you the food. If tomorrow Poland Spin makes an announcement, no more water for Muslims, what are we going to do? Or if they say Coke makes an announcement, no more Coke for Muslims, what are we going to do? Everything is being mass produced. Right? Medicine. The society has become such where the doctors nowadays have made it such where herbal medicine is deemed backwards. But if you look, there's a concept of Tibbun Nabawi. The Nabi Kareem Sassan himself used herbal medications. But now if you use herbal medications, they say this is not right. So what do? They give you vaccines, and they give you medicine, like Tylenol, all these things. And I was, 2 days ago, I was with the Jamaat, and the person was a biochemist. And he told me that every medicine has a side effect. Right? No medicine is free of side effects. What it's doing is, if you have a headache, this is not my field, you know? So if you have a headache, you still have that pain, but what the Tylenol does is it numbs you. So medicine is in control of these people also, right? Money is also in their control, right? If you look at the banks nowadays, Rasulullah mentions that when the time of the job comes or before it comes, money will be transitioned to paper, and then paper will be transitioned to digital. What's happening? Islam had what? Currency. What was currency? Dinar, dirham, gold and silver. When America came, if you look at the 1950s, they took all the gold in the world and they put it in Fort Knox, I believe. Anyone heard of Fort Knox before? I believe it's there. And now they forced, because America was a superpower, it's still a superpower, and they forced the people to convert to paper currency. And paper right now has no value. The only people who give a value is America. If they say tomorrow a dollar is worth $100, they have control over it. Gold, it has, Allah Ta'ala made it such where it has a value to it, but paper has no value. And now paper is being transitioned to digital. There's no more paper currency. We're living in the era, as we're speaking, of digital currency, e-currency, Bitcoin, Dogecoin. Some lady was sitting on Fox News, and she was saying, I'm gonna make my own cat coin and stuff like this. Whether it's jazz or not, that's not the discussion, but we're living in this era. And these people, they have control over their wealth. If they want, they can give you the wealth. If they don't want, they don't give you the wealth. They control your currency, right? They make all these Muslim currencies crash. They make it such that they make all these currencies crash. So, this is what's happening in regards to currency. Now, in regards to, I was mentioning food and water, right? They say nowadays that water that comes from a lake is not healthy for you. If there was no bottled water, what were the Muslims drinking back in the days? Do you think they had all these machines to make mineral water? What was anyone drinking back in the days? So, but what does society teach us? Society teaches us that no, you have to drink bottled water. What does it say on the water? It says natural spring water, it says something mineral. What do they say? Mineralized something water. This is an industry that they're making billions of dollars. And a lot of them what they put in the water. Right? I'm not going into conspiracy theories, but what happened was there was a person in South Africa. And this person mentions that he wanted to open up a water plant. And this was to give the community, the village and the area, water, fresh water. So before he wanted to open up the plant, the government came to give him a license. And everyone who's a businessman knows, for everything you need a license. And they have all these inspectors, they have a store, and they just like coming in, they give you tickets left and right, right? If you don't follow them, they control you. It's annoying, right? They give you the ticket. So now this person is saying that they wanted to give him a license, and they said that in order for you to get a license, you have to put this specific drop in your water. And what does this water do? What does that drop do? So, obviously Allah is the one who controls who is a male and who is a female in the womb of the mother, right? But in biology, they teach you X chromosome, Y chromosome, and they say that if one is over the other, then there's a chance that it's gonna be male, the chance it's gonna be female, feminine, right, female. So what these people do is they try to put this drop so that there's more females on the earth compared to men. And that's happening. We're supposed to mention the time will come where for every male, for every female, for every 50 females, there'll be one male, right? And that makes society such where even the men that we have nowadays are becoming more feminine, right? I'm sorry for being vulgar, but this is the truth, right? They're walking around and they're acting more feminine. And this is another topic in itself of how we have to preserve our masculinity, our amruwah, our manhood, right? Our manhood. I was walking in the parade. I mean, I wasn't part of it, but I was driving by, right? I'm not gonna get bashed. I'm walking, I'm just saying the kalima. You know, this is when the time where that from your heart it comes to the billahi rabba, that I am pleased to be a Muslim, you know? But bin Islami Dina, that alhamdulillah Allah gave me the Deen of Islam. Two guys holding hands, acting like females. What is this? It's you don't have to be the most intellectual person. You don't have to come to me your degrees and telling me that this is right. But this is what society says. He's expressing himself and he acts like this and they get emotional and they're crying for him and Nobel Prize is being given to these people. Bakwas. I can get backlash for this, but it's all bakwas. Right? So this is what people now they have control over the water and the food. Right? So now going back to the story of what's gonna happen, the Jaws of the Kunk. And he's going to come to the doors of Bayt al-Maqdis. And at this time, Imam Mahdi will be preparing to fight him. And while Imam Mahdi is preparing to fight him, the doors of Bayt al-Maqdis are closed. And these are styles that come down. I'm going to run through this because this is another topic in itself, but I'll give you the glimpse, just a quick story. Oh, one interesting story I mentioned is when Dajjal will come to Medina, there will be a man that will come out to Medina, from Medina to face Dajjal. Right? And then Dajjal will take this person and he will tell his people, do you want me to kill this person? And the people will be like, yeah, kill him, kill him. You know, it's like a whole parade and show. Kill that person. So Dajjal will kill that person. Now, after the Dajjal kills that person, he will look back at his followers and he will say, do you want me to bring this person back to life? And the people will say, yes, bring him back to life. Show us your power. And then the Dajjal will bring him back to life. And then that person who the Dajjal cut in half and he brought back to life, that person will say, I now know that you are the Dajjal. Anyone know who this person is? Anyone? Has anyone heard of Khidr alayhi salam? Khidr. Who's Khidr? Khidr was? When? What time did he live in? Khidr. Musa alayhi salam's time. So now there's a narration mentioned, some people, some scholars, very a weak opinion, but the opinion is there, that Khidr alayhi salam is still alive. Right? He's still alive. He lived at the time of Musa alayhi salam, and there's some narration that mentioned that he's still alive. Right? There's one, if you look at Ma'arif al-Quran, under the Tafsir of Surah Kahf, there's an interesting narration, wallahu a'lam, in regards to its authenticity, but it mentions that when Rasulullah has passed away, he was put there and the Sahaba were coming to mourn Rasulullah. And while this was happening, Abu Bakr and Ali radiallahu anhu, they narrate that one man came, and this man had a white beard. He came, he stood by the beard of Rasulullah and he cried, and he said some words and he left. So now Abu Bakr and Ali radiallahu anhu narrate that was Khidr. So this is a narration that exists that Khidr alayhi salam still walks the earth. He's still alive, right? You have a lot of Sufis, they believe that he's alive, and they say that we have met him. Some people, they say that I met him. So this person that the Dajjal will confront, some people even mention that he is Khidr alayhi salam. From the time of Musa alayhi salam, now he's facing the Dajjal. So this is one opinion also, that the Dajjal will be faced with Khidr alayhi salam. But who is the one to kill the Dajjal? Anyone know before I mention it? Isa alayhi salam. So now what happens is he comes to Bayt al-Maqdis Dajjal. Imam Mahdi is preparing the army, Isa comes down, and they bring the salah. Once the door opens, the Dajjal is ready to fight, and he sees Isa, and he goes, oh snap! Right? It's Isa alayhi salam, and he makes a run for it. He's running, all taught, but no game. Right? When he sees Isa alayhi salam, he starts running. And he starts running, trying to save himself from Isa alayhi salam, because he knows that Isa will be the one to end him. And the narration mentions that finally Isa alayhi salam will come and confront him at the Ba'ath of Lud. And this is located in Israel, but under the Zionist government. And that's the eastern Ba'ath of Israel. I think you can look it up. That's where Isa alayhi salam will end the fitna of the Dajjal. And he will cleanse the earth, everyone will be given da'wah to, there will be a time of peace. After all this fitna of trials where there's no food, there's no water, there's nothing, everything is in the control of the Dajjal. Again, this is all from the tawfiq of Allah. Meaning in the sense that this is all from Allah Azza wa Jalla. This is a test, and this is the biggest test. Imagine if food, water, medicine, wealth, everything is controlled under one person. Right? How are you going to react to that? Are you going to sell your deen? This is the question. Are we going to give our deen? And that is how we ask ourselves that if right now, speaking, if the Dajjal comes out, how do we face the Dajjal? Number one, we ask ourselves, are we ready to face the Dajjal? That's the first question, right? The Surah also mentions to us that there's two ways of facing the Dajjal. If right now announcement comes, BBC news comes, the Dajjal has come. Right? First of all, what's sad is people will say, oh, he's our savior. And he's coming to express and help us. What's wrong with him? People will be following him as he's a savior. But as Mufti Kama mentioned, the true Muslims at that time will be the ones who will be able to see through all this deception. Who will be able to see Kafa Allah on his head. And they'll be the ones to come back to Allah Azza wa Jalla. So now the first way of facing the Dajjal, Rasulullah mentions in the hadith, that you go and you spit in the face of the Dajjal. And you say the first verses of Surah Kahf. In other words, if you have the ability, if your iman is strong enough to face the fitna of the Dajjal, what do? You fight the Dajjal. You fight the Dajjal and you become shaheed. Become a martyr of Allah. So ask ourselves, do we have this capability? Yes or no? Are we ready to face the job? Everyone should ask ourselves, right? Is my iman strong? Yes or no? This is a question. Am I on the path of Allah Azza wa Jalla? Am I following the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla? Do I give my being preference over the dunya, or do I fall into the same trap? So that's the first way of facing the fit of the Dajjal. The second way, which also is in my case, because Rasulullah mentioned the hadith, that if you hear of the Dajjal, what do? Run away. You run away. Why? Because Rasulullah mentioned in the hadith of Abu Dawud that a person will come. He will try to face the Dajjal. He says, I'm ready. I can face the Dajjal. But the hadith, Rasulullah mentions that this person will become the believer of the Dajjal after facing him. This is the fitna of the Dajjal. It's not no easy fitna. So the second way we face the fitna of the Dajjal, if he comes in our time, is make hijrah. Right? We move. We try to find a place where there's less fitna. Right? In the place where there's no fitna. And this is something I don't want to bring up. I might face a lot of backlash in regards to this, but ask ourselves. This is a serious question. Those who came from Afghanistan, and now they're living here in America, the kids, if their kid went astray, Allah would ask you that you were the one who came to America. Now you put your kid's life in astray. You were the means for your kid becoming astray. So what do you do now? Right? There's a narration in the Yahya Salihin that a person came and he killed 99 people. And he asked the person, can Allah forgive me? The person said, no, you killed 99 people. That person kills him also, 100 people. So now he goes to an alim, a scholar, and that scholar says, in order for you to protect yourself and better, you move. Hijrah, you migrate. I'm not telling anyone to leave America. I myself am born in New York City. But this is something to keep in mind. It's not something small. Every single one of us will be asked that if you came to America for a better life, what does a better life mean? What does a better life mean? Are you falling and putting yourself in the fitna of the Dajjal, the trap of the Dajjal? Or are you able to be Musa alayhi salam in the house of Fir'aun? Or Musa alayhi Fir'aun at that time, he was trying to kill Musa alayhi salam before he came. But in the very house of Fir'aun, Musa alayhi salam was growing. So are we able to be the forebears of Islam and protect our religion? Allah says, "Qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nar." Protect yourself and protect your family from the fire. So if you, Allah says, "Ala kullukum ra'in wa kullukum mas'ulun 'an ra'iyatihi." Every single one of you are responsible, and every single person will be asked to watch responsibility. So for the fathers out here, I ask, taking care of your child is a responsibility. Allah will ask, if you can't, no problem. It's not haram being in America. But first, preserve your deen and the deen of your family. Right? This is a responsibility. And that's, and now if we ask ourselves, if we cannot protect our family, then we should look for alternatives, right? It's not that it's only America that's the light. I'm not telling you not to leave America, but this is something to keep in mind, right? And then last advice I'll give is general advice in regards to how we can always protect ourselves from the fitna of the Dajjal. Right? The Islam is such where it's not a title, it's a way of life. So in order for us to protect ourselves for the fitna of the Dajjal, any fitna, number one is learning about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In order for you, even in war, in order for you to combat the enemy, you have to learn about the enemy. Right? In order for you to combat the enemy, you have to learn about the enemy. So the first counter to the Dajjal is learning about the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is haq, what is batil? That's the first one. Number two is dua, right? Making dua to Allah Ta'ala. Even Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to make dua that Allah minni a'udhubika min fitnati Dajjal. Oh Allah, protect me from the fitna of the Dajjal. Imagine Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam making this dua that, oh Allah, protect me from the fitna of the Dajjal. So the second is making dua. The third is dhikr of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. I mentioned that at the time when the Dajjal comes, the Dajjal will have all the food under his control. What will be our food? What will be our provision? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba, they asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if this is the case, what are we going to eat? If the Dajjal has all the food, and if we don't want to submit to the Dajjal. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the tadbeer of Allah will be your provision. The tadbeer of Allah will be your provision. And the tasbih of Allah will be your provision, your food. Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, ila hamd will be your provision. So number three is having the dhikr of Allah azza wa jalla. And finally is Surah Kahf. Surah Kahf, first 10, last 10. This is a thing, but as Muslims, we should memorize the whole Surah Kahf. And if you look, and advice is Surah Kahf is a way of protecting yourself from materialism. It's a faith versus materialism, right? So number four is Surah Kahf. And all these things should be implemented in your life. May Allah give us tawfiq, as one has been said. May Allah give us tawfiq to protect from the fitna of the Dajjal, right? I'll end off by saying that these programs that take place, what happens is, one time, the Sahaba came to Rasulullah sallallahu and he said, Ya Rasulullah, when we go to our home, what happens? We feel like munafiqeen. Why? Because our iman goes down. But Rasulullah said that when you're with, and the Sahaba said, when you're with you, Ya Rasulullah, when we're with you, we feel like Jahannam and Jannah are in front of us. This is what the Sahaba told Rasulullah. So Rasulullah said, this is normal, this is natural. In other words, always try to find these gatherings where the remembrance of Allah is being remembered, Allah is being remembered. And this environment is a means of us preserving our iman and creating this environment of good. That's the responsibility of a believer. Alhamdulillah, Jazakallah khairan for this masjid, to holding this program, for allowing us to come. Al-Hikm Institute, spread the word, Al-Hikm Institute. That's Alhamdulillah, we started this institute. Why? It's to bring this back to the community. Learn, ponder, and practice. This is our philosophy. Learn, ponder, practice. This is the philosophy of what the Rasulullah said. May Allah give us the free to act upon what has been said. May Allah give us the free to participate in the Fitr of the Dajjal. Our request will be common, inshallah, to make the dua, and then we'll end off, inshallah. We have food also, inshallah.